So a new episode of Founder in Car, and today we will discuss DRIP. And DRIP stands for Dividend Reinvestment Plan. So what does that mean? If you have Tesla making all these beeps because it's quite narrow here. But normally you have an investment, for example stocks, into a company. And if a company makes profit, oftentimes they also pay out dividend. So dividend you can see as like a return on investment next to the value growth the company can make. But if you look at dividend, dividend is like the eggs a chicken produces. So for example, you bought a part of the chicken, 10% of the chicken, so 10% of those eggs are also for you, and in this case. And with a DRIP, so Dividend Reinvestment Plan, abbreviated, you get that dividend and you reinvest that. And a dividend reinvested can be in the same chicken, so for example, you have 10% of the chicken in my example, and you also get 10% of the eggs, and those eggs are a certain value. For example, the chicken is worth 100 euro, so you invested 10 euro in the chicken, and then you get the eggs, and the eggs can be daily, for example, in my example. But normally dividend is paid out once a year, or once a quarter, or once a month, depends on the strategy that they use. But for example, if we take those eggs that you get once a month, so to say, and the value of those eggs could be like 50 euro. So if that's 50 euro, you get 10% of that, is 5 euros. So, and you reinvest that in another chicken, then you have 5% of one chicken and 10% of the other. Or if you reinvest it in the same chicken, you would have, instead of 10%, 15% of that chicken the next month. So the next month, again, you get the eggs that are of a certain value. In this case, the eggs are still the value of 50 euros of that month. And you get 15% of that 50 euros. So you, instead of getting 5 euro, you get 7.50 euro. And that is reinvested again into the chicken. And now you have, instead of the 10% you started with, 22.5%. And then the next month you get 50 euros, and you get 22.5% of that. So that's the principle around DRIP. And the benefit is that if you have a strategy, a buy and hold strategy, this is, so sometimes people buy stocks and just for the value growth and then resell them once they have reached a certain value growth and then buy others or the same stocks again. But with a DRIP, if you keep these shares that pay dividend for a longer period of time, you can have value upon value. So if you would compare it with a normal saving accounts, it would be rent upon rent. So the rent that you get, the return on investment, in this case a dividend, is also invested again, so it can get you additional dividend, like rent upon rent. If you have rent, if you get a percentage of the money that you invest in opportunity A, B or C, or on your saving accounts, and you reinvest that, you can also get rent or a percentage of that value on the reinvested money that you received from rent in the earlier phase. And this DRIP type of reasoning can, depending of course on how much the value is of those dividends, can double the returns over a longer period of time. But of course, there's also a thing that you should take into consideration. You will not be getting those eggs to eat for yourself at this time. But of course, the benefit with the drip is that you still can plan to take out a part of the dividend for yourself, for example, and reinvest the other part. So there are some mixes to be made. And of course, if you are not in need of that extra income, you can make the extra income in the future to be even bigger. And that's the entirety of this planning, so to say. Well, almost there. It's a little bit different this time. I hope you like these videos. If you do, please let me know in the comments. And also feel free to subscribe. I made a different playlist that's named Founder in Car, so you will find many a video that has similar beneficial attributes as this video. Please check it out. Have a great day. Bye bye. In this Founder in Car, we will discuss about assets. Do you want something that produces X, or do you want something that produces you a fat chicken? So we all know and love, probably if you're not a vegetarian, chicken meat, because it's lean and high in proteins. And also if you're not allergic, very often you will like eggs. I'm allergic to eggs, too bad, because I do like them. But there, did you know that there is a different type of chicken that produces meat? So a chicken that will grow very fast into quite a big type of chicken, and then you can sacrifice it for the meat. That's a different kind than the one that is producing eggs. So there are also chicken that lay very many eggs in a lifetime. So at least one egg a day, and sometimes even two or more. And those chickens are best suited for producing eggs. And that's the same with assets. Some assets will produce eggs, cash flow, so to say. So they, every month or every year or every quarter, they will produce something of value that you can use and then again use to buy some other assets or to just live on or something else. Whereas some other assets, they are quite static, but they will grow from that little baby chicken into a very big chicken that once you have to sell it, or once you will sell it, so for example some years, they will be grown so much that you have a surplus of value. And for both there's something to say. The benefit of this chicken that grows extensively is that normally you don't have to manage it. It's just a buy and hold strategy, and then if you sell it or sacrifice in the case of the chicken, you will get the returns. The benefit, however, of this cash flow generating assets, so those assets that produce eggs, is that you can have a steady income stream, and oftentimes also those assets will increase a little bit in value. Oftentimes not as much as those flesh chickens, so to say, that they are just there for producing meat, but they do increase in value very often. And there's also another thing. What you can do is, for example, if you have 100 and that 100 produces like a return on investment of 9% or 10%, make it 10% for easy calculations, then that 1,000 that produces 10% will give you 100 each year, and that 100 can already be invested in 1/10 of the same asset. So that's, if you want to, you can also make a cash flow generating asset grow in value extensively, because you will just add on the cash flow in new assets of the same class or a different class. So that's the benefit. That being said, there's also something like in nature. Chickens grow by becoming older and also produce eggs, and also sometimes on farms you see this. those chickens, they are just there to produce eggs predominantly often. And once they are getting older or don't produce as much, they will be slaughtered and used for meat. This is quite often the case in developing countries as well. And that could also be a good thing. So for example, if you have something that has a good asset, produces a good cash flow, and once that plummets down, you can sell it and get the extensive benefit of the growth, if applicable as well, and then invest again in another asset that is still youthful and able to produce cash flow again. And how come an asset that was cash flow positive could diminish, for example, if it's getting older and needs more care, and also, for example, renovations are needed. And if you are not able to perform those, then it will be quite hard to stay as attractive to, for example, renters, and for you to produce this cash flow out of this asset. So I hope this short introduction helped you to decide what kind of asset that you are looking for. But as I mentioned, there are also mixed type, and either that you force it to be to, for example, to make a cash flow generating assets, to invest in itself again each year so that you get more assets of the same, for example, that are still producing. You can, if you don't need the cash flow, you can do that, or you can also opt for something that's a little bit of both, which can also be a good way to approach it. Well, have a great day. This was Founder in Car. See you next time. Bye bye. So this is another Founder in Car, and today we will discuss, should you focus on thinking things through, or should you act? And a long story short, of course, it's necessary to consider the cost that you're going to start with. So preparation is important, but don't keep in that cycle of discussing everything. And also go and act. Sometimes it's better to be first than to be perfect. So that doesn't mean that you just go there and don't make it, but if you're the first one that makes it, very often time, that's a good thing to start with. And I can only talk as a man, but also just be a man. Of course, there are girls that are also doing the things and really putting effort in, but very often it's also expected for men to act. But nowadays, a lot of men are that weak and just thinking, discussing and talking. And just do something. Make it happen. And if you make it happen, you will learn so much of that experience as well. It was a little bit tight turn. Some people just think that you learn only in theory, but in practice, that's where it's at. So if you learn in practice, you are applying the theory. You're applying the things that you, the knowledge that you gained. And if you apply that knowledge, it becomes wisdom. So be wise. And if you're wise, and if you're acting, your wisdom will increase, because that experience will grant you so much additional insights, which can then also be used to rethink the situation again and do something else, learn from it. But you keep on moving in a good direction, going up that hill instead of just talking at the foot of the hill, at the foot of those hills. How would it be? Should we do it like this? Should we do it like that? And of course, sometimes it will help. And I'm not saying that you should not be prepared, because you should. But also, you will never be really prepared if you never tasted it. Because if you take all the preparation in the world and then you meet the real world and you start doing it, you will face things that are completely off to the things that you put in your mind, you had a hypothesis, it would be like this, and then I act like that, and then the real world hit you. It's like Mike Tyson says, everyone or everybody, depends on what quote you are referring to, has a plan until they get hit in the mouth. So of course, also even a boxer, which is a fighter, he has a plan to approach Mike Tyson. But once Mike Tyson hits them, their beliefs can completely be destroyed, shattered. Very often he's known for his knockout power. And that's also how real life works. So you have to get a little bit of taste of that to see if that plans that you put in your mind, and which is a good thing. Eh? I'm not dissing anything about making a plan. I think you should make a plan. But the plan should also involve tasting the real experience, doing the work, and then improve your plan. And not just standing there and do nothing, or just dipping a toe in the water and then go back again and cry to mommy. Because in my experience, a lot of people are doing that. And then when you are doing it, and you go through all that hardships, pain, blood, sweat and tears, they don't care, because they say, okay, you're your own boss, you decided to do this. But once you get a little bit of taste of success, they said, okay, you have it easy. You are in that position. I'm not there. I wish I was there. But you didn't wish you was there, because you only want to reap the results, the benefits, the good things, but you're not willing to put in the hard work. Sorry to say, but that's the truth. And if you are doing the hard work, and even if you are failing, I salute to you. I respect you, that you try to do and make things happen. And of course, you have a brain for something, use it. But also use your vitality, your force, your life force, your body, your experience, and just further refine that skill that you have in your mind. And that your mind refine as well the effort that you're putting in there. And do it like that, instead of just whining from the side and not getting involved. Get involved. Get busy with it. Well, if you like this video, feel free to subscribe. If you didn't like it, feel free to not subscribe or unsubscribe. Have a great day. So another founder in car, and this will be an investment video. So in investment, you invest in something that's called an asset that can produce something. So for example, very easy example, you invest in a chicken so that chicken either, that small chicken becomes bigger and you can sell it for more, or which is my idea, that the chicken produces some eggs which you can sell. So you don't have to slaughter the chicken or sell the chicken, but you have a little bit of the investment coming back to you all the time. And an important thing to consider then is, if you invest something, for example, 1,000 euro in project A, and project A gives you a revenue of, for example, 6% in return on investment, so to say. You should always compare it to what the next best thing will deliver, or a certain amount of return on investment. For example, if you could loan it to something else, you could get like 4% return on investment, then that delta, the difference will be 5%. No, only 6% was the other. No, so then the delta would be 2%. So in other words, that project A will give 50% more return on investment, because 6% is 50% more than 4%, than the next best thing that you have quite as certain as an investment. So always, also if you have to invest money in something, take into consideration the cost of lost opportunity. So that's what we are talking about here. And that doesn't mean that your one investment doesn't work, because they can still work, but perhaps it would be wiser to consider another investment if the next best thing gives you a better return on investment. Or, for example, in this case, if that 4% is guaranteed and that 6% has a risk that you can lose the entire sum. So you get, for example, in this this project A, you would get 60 euros per year in return on investment, next to the 1,000 euro you already had. But you have a risk to lose everything. For example, 5% chance of losing everything. Whereas the other one would give you 40 euros of return, but guaranteed. So you have 0% chance of losing everything. And you have, in project A, you have 5% chance of losing everything. And that 5% chance is already 50 euros that you can lose. On average, you can also lose everything, but on average you would be losing 50 euros. So you then, the difference between that 40 and 60 euros would be 20 euros. So you have to keep on, let's say the chance of losing everything, that 5% chance of project A, should be on average at least 2.5 years in time, because it's a chance each month, it's each year, something like that, but it should at least be 2.5 years to even break even with that other opportunity, that's opportunity B, so to say. It gives you the 4% return on investment. So that's also a thing to consider, and only then would we break even. So normally, especially because there's uncertainty, it could also be a lot shorter or a little bit longer. Project B, that gives you a smaller return on investment, only 4%, would be wiser on average. I hope this is a little bit understandable. But also, for example, some people, they take a loan on their car even when they have the money sitting there, because they think they can, if they loan the money for the car, that's better than they would invest the money that they have on their account, because the money on their account could be used for a better use. And for example, the loan on the car would be like 3%, and then in our example they could have 4% return on investment if they don't invest it in the car and just take the loan. And that's the difference then would be then 1%. If they are loaning 1,000 euros, it's just 10 euros a year. But for example, if the car costs you 20,000 euros, it would be the 10 euros times 20, so 200 euros a year, which makes a difference. If it's more expensive, of course, it will be more expensive. Hope this helps. Great day to you all. Bye bye.